Ferrofluid degrades over time. We've seen this effect in our own tests and in commercially bought products that we've used for comparison.
Two important properties of a ferrofluid container are a smooth surface that the ferrofluid won't stick to, and a suspension fluid that maintains the viscosity of the ferrofluid.
In this video, we'll struggle with both.
I'm Amund.
I'm Simon.
Welcome to Applied Procrastination.
In the first episode of Applied Procrastination, we saw this cheap eBay ferrofluid that had gone completely solid after a few weeks of use.
But we also saw the savior bottle, which we used to verify our electronics. This bottle is a high-quality commercial desk toy, which has been perfected to stay liquid over time. But it now also has other defects.
If we look closely, we can see a cloudy layer above the ferrofluid, and we also see some small particles of what looks like rust.
The ferrofluid is also starting to stick more to the side of the tank than it used to. But in general, this display has way higher quality than ours.
In the case of our prototype, we saw degradation happening over time, and after 9 to 10 months, we thought, hold up, this isn't good enough anymore, we have to fix it.
Yeah, but this part of the process was expected, and we were just happy that our display lasted as long as it did.
That's because ferrofluid consists of small iron particles in an oil solution, and while we're no chemists, our understanding is that these iron particles have an anticoagulant coating, which breaks down after a while, and that results in clumpy ferrofluid.
Yeah, so in this film, we'll try to revive our old prototype by filling it with fresh ferrofluid in order to do some more testing before we start building our full-scale fetch. Say hi to Anush. He is the chemist in our team, and he made the arrangements to get us access to a lab at the University of Oslo.
We use a commercial ferrofluid called EFH1 by Ferrotech, and the process we use is largely based on a very detailed instructable that we'll post a link to down in the description.
This instructable reveals some tricks that the author has found to help with their containers that have been successfully displayed at American museums over several years.
One such trick is to reduce the EFH1 ferrofluid by 10% in weight. To do this at 100 degrees Celsius takes a few hours, so that's the first thing we get going. But stop! If you're using this video as a tutorial, don't do this step yet. If we had just followed our own notes, we would have easily discovered that this step shouldn't be done until a few days after the rest of the procedure. But we'll come back to that later in the video.
Anyway, the author claims that careful heating will evaporate some of the lighter hydrocarbons in the oil that surrounds the iron nanoparticles. This will make the ferrofluid less sticky on the glass and more viscous, which improves the visual effects.
Next up, we need to clean out the container, which is easier said than done. Our plan was to just empty the tank and let it sit in a basic solution for about an hour. But the mess that revealed itself when we poured out the old ferrofluid made us clean it with hydrochloric acid first, since that was easily available in our lab. When that was done, we threw it in the base bath.
While the basic solution did its magic, we had time to saturate some distilled water with salt. For this, we used molten salt, which is kosher. The reason for this is to avoid the anti-clumping agent used in regular table salt. It is possible to weigh up the perfect amount of salt for the amount of water needed, but the easiest procedure is just to keep pouring salt until it stops dissolving.
When the brine is completely saturated, it should be filtered. We found that the molten salt introduced a lot of foreign particles to the water, which is undesirable. So we filtered our brine twice in order to get it properly clean.
Now we're almost done. You just need to neutralize the tank since it's been soaked in basic solution and then fill it in brine and ferrofluid. Or is it really that simple?
Turns out the answer is no. At this point, we skip an important step, which is to let the salt water settle in the tank. In our earlier experiments, we had left the tank alone for a week between pouring in salt water and pouring in ferrofluid. This time, we completely forget. We pour the ferrofluid in right away, and the result is this abomination. That didn't work out quite as we had hoped.
But this did! We managed to do it! Big time! Woo! Okay.
Video's coming up in a few weeks. But next week, we're doing this. The magnet matrix. How cool is that? See you next time. Happy procrastinating.
I'm not totally useless. I can be used as a bad example.
Happy procrastinating.